At this time, y'all are in for a treat, okay? We have Mansfield Pete Key III, and he is a renowned growth development strategist and international motivational speaker. He has certification in counseling, leadership, and HIV/AIDS instruction, and is a skilled life coach, mentor, consultant, and speechwriter. He has worked with the U.S. federal government, various state departments of education, public health, and international organizations, including the Dream Development Center of Johannesburg, South Africa, and the Hope Organization in Liverpool, England. Mr. Key is the creator of the Lunch with the Keys program, which teaches character education to students and has earned recognition for its excellence. He received several awards for his work, including Humanitarian of the Year and Auburn University's Hero Award. He is a graduate of the Leadership Alabama and past president of the Florence Rotary Club. He is also the coordinator of student athlete development at the University of North Alabama Athletic Department. He has authored 3 books and released multiple DVDs, CDs, and curriculums. He is married to Charlene, and they have 2 daughters, Erin and Joy Key. He credits his relationship with God as his greatest accomplishment and aims to inspire others by sharing his story and his strategies. Please welcome Pete Key.
Some good stuff there. About to pay you for that one. Good morning. Rotarians, how you feeling this morning? Great. Listen, so last night I was doing a sound check, and I just screamed out. It was just the staff, and I asked this question. They said, you ought to start with that. I said, Mr. Francis, are you sure? He said, yeah. So we're going to start with a question, right? And I'm going to ask you the question. Did they leave? Okay, I got 2 of my books, right. So whoever answers these questions can get this book before I even get started. So the question is, tell me what's more powerful than God, more evil than the devil, and if you stop eating it, you still won't die. Who said that? Come on, give it up. Come on up. Yes. Everyone say nothing. Come on, let me hear it. Say nothing. See, you just got your 2 books. Come on. You got to come and look. Yeah, that was good. Everyone say hope is the key. So that's what we're going to talk about today, right? Thank you. You did a great job. I don't know. How did you come up with? No, just kidding. So today I'm going to talk about hope. Hope is defined and described as a feeling of expectation that something good is about to happen. Meaning that you can sense something good about to happen when you have hope. Everyone say hope. So I always say hope is the key. So I'm going to give you 5 things to think about today, right? How many things?
5.
And I'm going to move really quick, right? The first one is sacrifice. Everyone say sacrifice. If you're going to be a Rotarian, you're going to have to sacrifice. And you cannot make the impact unless you have the influence. And you don't have the influence unless you make the investment. So first thing we have to do is make the investment. The first thing we have to do is invest our time. Sometimes we have to invest our money. But then we get the chance to make the influence, and we get the chance to make that huge impact, right? And it's all, I mean, every single day we get that. Now, 2, everyone say encourage.
Encourage.
We're gonna move quick. We all have to be encouraged. We all have to have that, oh, you got this, you can do this, right? But sometimes we have days when we don't feel like encouraging others. I need 5 volunteers real quick that got some energy that can come meet me on stage. Anyone, come on up. Yes, that's 1. Come on up, that's 2. Come on up, that's 3. 4, come on, one more. Come on, yes. Y'all give them a hand, because they don't know what they're about to do, right? Come on up. They're looking like, oh my God, what is this? Now, We're going to spray it out, right? We're going to spray it out. This is good. Thank you all for coming up.
You're welcome.
Not making me feel alone, right? Oh, give her a hand. She's coming, right? Now, everyone say, sunshine on a cloudy day. See, that's what Rotarians do. We bring sunshine on a cloudy day. If there's peace where there's conflict, if there's water, clean water, if there's a community that needs hope, Rotarians are there. Eradicating polio, that's sunshine on a cloudy day for someone. So we're going to do this song. We're going to sing. Yeah. So we gotta go. One, two, one, two. All right. And then when they say, my girl, my girl, my girl, we're gonna say, Rotary, 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 talking about Rotary. I love it. You got it? I love it. All right, all right. Are you ready?
I'm here.
All right. I don't know how that happened, but all right, here we go. All right, here we go. Go talk this way first. There you go. One, two.
I got sunshine on a what? On a cloudy day.
Come on, Rotarians. When it's cold outside and it's cold.
When it's cold outside. I got the wonder band.
Come on. All together. Sing it like you mean it. Come on. Time. I guess you say, what can make me feel this way? Rotary, 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 talking about Rotary. I love it. All right, great job, great job, great job, great job, great job. Yes, yes. You know, standing here now just looking out like, I remember when Allgood and I were just meeting with Chuck, trying to see if we could come up with some new ideas to kind of boost our club, right? And you know, we didn't know the pandemic was gonna hit, right? I mean, and here I am on Zoom. I still remember when I had my first, here I am, I got the gavel. Our next president is Pete Key. And I'm standing outside in a church parking lot, and the members are in the cars listening to me on the radio. They had a radio dial. And I say, I'm the president. I'm so excited. And they would, I say, honk your horn two times, and you hear, bump. That's how I started out. Everyone say, respond. So that's the thing. So scholar, show scholar, dollar. That's what really provoked me to join Rotary. You know, locally we have a program that was started by the Rotary Club, by the Rotarians, that sends every high school student who makes a certain GPA and their attendance is at a certain level and no behavior problems for free. 14 different high schools, they get to go to the community college and the University of North Alabama. Everyone say, for free.
Free.
And that's what pushed me into Rotary. And then, how did I become president? Probably the same way a lot of, how many president-elects we have in here? I missed the meeting. And he said, man, everybody think that you would make a great president. He said, everyone, we voted. We want you to be. I fell for it, right?
Superstations in the Shells are celebrating 100 years in operation.
News 19's Jeremy Jackson explains how the organizations are funding a creative and interactive project to give back to the community.
Monday afternoon was the centennial celebration for two Rotary clubs in the Shoals, with Sheffield being formed in 1920 and Florence in 1921. Florence Rotary President Pete Key says the occasion speaks volumes on how far the organization has come since its inception.
To think that in 1921, when this club was first developed, when it was first formed, a person who looked like me probably couldn't even become a member. But to think on this 100-year anniversary, I'm the president, you know, it shows that we've come a long way.
And in keeping with the tradition of progress, the Florence Rotary, Greater Shoals Sheffield Rotary, and UNA Rotaract Clubs announced the founding of the Rotary Star Park, a sensory, tactile, and adaptive recreation playground for all children. It's an idea that Florence Mayor Andy Betterton suggested when the clubs were deciding on a project for the anniversary. The Star Park will be located in McFarland Park underneath the O'Neill Bridge. It will feature playground equipment that's easily accessible by children with special needs.
I have a special needs grandson, and so that was the perfect, as far as I was concerned, park for our job for the Rotary Club to take on.
Equipment will include interactive boards, communication panels with sign language and braille, and a wheelchair tricycle track. The playground will be the first of its kind in the Shoals that's available for public use.
If your presence doesn't add value, your absence won't make a difference. And I believe that as Rotarians, we're adding value to this community, and our presence is making a difference.
In Florence, Jeremy Jackson, News 19.
The estimated...
All right, that's good. So, everyone say value. So you heard me share that quote, if your presence doesn't add value, your absence won't make a difference. So how are we adding value to the community? How are we adding value to the world by being Rotarians? You know, I heard a man say one day that took his wife to the doctor. Well, he went to the doctor. He said, "Doc, there's something wrong with my wife. She doesn't want to clean. She doesn't want to cook. She doesn't want to be intimate. Doc, she don't want to do anything." Doc said, "Where is she?" He said, "She's in the lobby." And he went and got her. He said, "Well, bring her up." And he went and got her, and she came. And the doctor said, "Is that her? Oh, she's beautiful. She's a great mother. Oh, she's a great wife. Oh, she's a great supporter. Oh, she's..." And just, the wife was just smiling. And the man said, "You know, I hadn't seen that smile in years." And he looked at the doctor. And the doctor said, "I know what's wrong." He said, "Doc, you got to tell me what's wrong, because I need to know." He said, "She needs that at least 3 or 4 days a week." He said, "3 or 4 days a week?" "Yes, she need to be encouraged. She need to be told." He said, "3 or 4 days a week." He said, "Doc, I play golf 3 or 4 days a week. I'll bring her by here so you can give that to her." Once he found out what needed to be done, he didn't want to do it, right? He wanted to delegate, you know. You know how we do it. We're going to get a committee and then get a subcommittee. All right. And then we go see, well, what is the problem? What is the, you know. But what would the world look like if Rotary didn't exist? When we talk about imagine Rotary. You know, I always talk about connecting the world through Rotary. Hope. Everyone say hope. I mean, you talk about 1.2 million, what, 35,000 clubs, 200 different countries, 99.9% eradicating polio. That's what we do. That's who we are. Everyone say empathize. So, give you all five. ATM of my end. Everyone say ATM. Just lean over just a little bit, right? And say this with me. Appreciate the moment. Let me hear it.
Appreciate the moment.
See, because a couple of years ago, we couldn't even meet like this. A couple of years ago, everyone was in their home and thinking about COVID. But to be able to be here now, we have to appreciate the moment. It's like the man who got the call from the doctor. The doctor said, "Hey, the man said, Doc, please just give it to me straight, Doc." And he said, "Well," he said, "Doc, just give it to me straight, Doc." He said, "Okay, I got bad news and I have very bad news." He said, "Give me the bad news first." You know, he said, "You have 24 hours to live." He said, "Well, Doc, What could be worse than that? He said, I forgot to call you yesterday to tell you. Everyone say it could always be worse. So we have to appreciate the moment. I just gave you that right real quick. Let's do that. Sacrifice, encourage, respond, value, and empathize. Sacrifice for others, encourage others, respond to others, value others, empathize with others. Right, so I always tell a story about, I remember I was in middle school, had a teacher. She said, Pete Key, go to the front of the class and read Shakespeare. I said, you're the teacher, you go to the front of the class and read Shakespeare. Everyone started laughing. She sent me to the office. I get to the office, the principal's like, hey, big guy, you ready for the game today? Because I was a basketball player. And he allowed me to stay in the office. 20 points that night, 8 assists, 8 rebounds. But when I got back to school the next day, that same teacher, she said, P.K., are you going to go to the front of the class and read Shakespeare? Or would you like to take a trip to the office for another one of your wisecracks? I remember walking up to the front of the coach. She said, sit down, his friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. At that moment, I went from being the cool basketball jock with all the girls to the dumb kid from the west side who couldn't read. I remember balling up my fist, getting ready to walk. She said, no, wait. Everyone left the room. She said, hey, don't worry. People from your neighborhood hadn't read many books, so you don't need to know how to read that well to do what you're going to do in life anyway. Get home from school. My mom said, hey, your dad left this morning. We're getting a divorce. He's on drugs. What? Crying myself to sleep. 2 younger brothers. Go back to school the next day. Like this. One teacher, Miss Stock, said, P.K., come here, what is this about you cannot read? You're one of my brightest students. You know the Balashello. You know the Civil War. How is it you can make A? I said, Miss Stock, this is the way you teach. Miss Stock, she said, Pete, if you can't read, but you can remember whatever you hear, you have a gift. And she gave me this thing called a cassette tape player. And she told me to just read and record myself. And if I heard it, I could remember it. And I had a gift. And she said, I got a little girl in another classroom who can really help you get on the ball. I said, Miss Stocker, she pretty, she can help me do anything. And Miss Stocker asked her, she said no. I asked her, she said no. And then Miss Stocker said, I don't think she likes little boys who can't read, Pete. Eventually that little girl said yes. We've been married over 25 years. We had a daughter getting a master's at Auburn University and one at Alabama State. Because one teacher saw something in us that we didn't see in ourselves. And I moved back to Alabama and I'm walking in this store and this man was on a walker. And he's coming out of the Longhorn. And I'm trying to walk in. I got my daughter and my wife. And so when he walks out, once he gets out on the walker, he leans against the door. When he does that, here come old lady on the walker, and I'm looking like, Miss Stockett, is that you? She said, P.K., I've heard some. I said, Miss Stockett, you changed my life. Miss Stockett, I've been to Africa. Miss Stockett, I've been to Europe. Miss Stockett, I've been with Steve Hart. Miss Stockett, I've written the book. Miss Stockett, she said, P.K., if you've written the book, there is a God. You were terrible. And she said, if I had known that it touched you like that, I would have done more. She said, that was my assignment. And that's what birthed my second book, that someone's destiny is tied to your assignment. Everyone say this. Say, someone's destiny is tied to my assignment. President, it's not just a position. It's something you're supposed to change in that community. It's something that you're going to change within that club. It's something that you're going to change within that district. I'm standing here right now because of Miss Stocker. I said, Miss Stocker, why did you do all that?
Hey, buddy, you know, service above self.
I'm standing right here because
somebody sacrificed, because somebody encouraged, because somebody responded to a need when they saw it, because somebody added value. You cannot add value to a person that you don't value as a person. And because she empathized, when she told me what they used to say about her in the break room, I said, "Miss Duggan, I didn't." She said, "Oh, baby, it don't matter to me. God had me." But they used to talk about it because she used to help little guys who looked like me. What I'm saying right now is all of us have an opportunity to create that word called hope. Everyone say hope. When I say hope, I want you to remember helping other people excel. Say that with me. Helping other people excel. As Rotarians, what do? Help other people excel. The other part of hope is having only positive expectations. Meaning that I'm seeing it. If I went around the room, everyone in this room is hoping for something. Hoping that my kids get a college degree. I'm hoping that my wife stay with me. I hope this guy quit screaming and jumping around the stage. I hope we have a good lunch. Everyone's hoping for something. Everyone say hope. Because hope is the key. Helping other people excel. Everyone say never lose hope. In Africa right there. And I was going every 2 years before the pandemic. And I would do students, and I mean, I would have a great time. Keep me posted on time, because I would keep going. Okay. Let me know how much time. I'm good? You sure? 20 minutes. Okay. Gotcha. If I got 20 minutes, no. So, when I was first over there, I would go in this school, and I would go in this school, and I would go in this school, and they would be like, you are hope. You bring us so much hope. And they were just going and talking about hope. And I always said, and I love it, I was telling a story about it, and I tell this story, and then I close, right? So the man, you heard the story about the man was walking, and he falls in the hole, boom. When he falls in the hole, they say a Baptist preacher walked by, "Oh my God, you're down in the hole. Hey, I'm going to pray that the Lord get you out of that hole, young man." And he dropped the Bible down in the hole. He said, "Read that, and it'll get you out of the hole." And the man was down there going, "Help, help, help." And the man was still stuck down in the hole. See, a female walked by. She was part of another club. We're not going to call any names. So she walked by. "Oh, my God, you're down in the hole. Wow. I just wrote a book called 7 Steps on How to Get Out of the Hole. I did my dissertation on it. Man, I dropped the book. Read that and it will give you the 7 steps on how to get out of the hole." And the man was still down there screaming, "Help! Help! Help!" And they see a Rotarian walk by, right? And said, so the man's going, "Help! Help!" He said, "Oh my God." He's stuck in the hole. "Hey, listen. Hey, you all go get the fire department. Hey, take this money. Hey, we're going to get a fund together. We're going to get it together. We're going to get somebody to drop a ladder." And then he jumped down in the hole with him. And said, so the man said, "What's wrong with you, man? You could have dropped the ladder. You could have dropped the rope. You could have went and got help. You jumped down in the hole. Now both of us are stuck in the hole. What were you thinking about? Why would you jump down in the hole with what?" And he said, "I jumped down in the hole because I know what it's like to be in a hole. And you can't tell a person how to get out of the hole. You have to show them. So I jumped down in the hole so I could show you how to get out of that hole. Is it fair to all concerned? Is it, will it bring goodwill, brother? Come on, let me." And he walked him out of the hole, right? And the whole moral is, when we see someone in a hole, do we love them or do we judge them? Do we help them or do we hinder them? Everyone say ATM. If we're going to appreciate the moment, then we have to appreciate the moment and say, this is where we are. How many, everyone in here have a bank statement, right? You know, before we started doing everything online, but you used to have to put money in and you would go to the ATM to do what? Get money out. And you couldn't get anything out if you hadn't what? If you hadn't put anything in, you couldn't get anything out. We'll never be able to master the next moment until we master the now moment. You know, next year we're going to do this. You know, we see the problem. Well, right now we cannot address it. But sometimes we have to do what we can while we are with what we have. So when I was in Africa, you thought I forgot about the story, right? When I was in Africa, I had just done all of these schools in there for like 30 days. This last day, my flight left at 6 p.m. that night. It's about 8 o'clock that morning. I wanted to get to the airport early. I wanted to purchase some things. And, hey, we get one more school. One more school. I said, man, God, my flight is today. I'm packed. You got to do this school. This school is special. It's the kids with special needs. Special needs school. I said, oh, okay, how do I? I've never done a special. What grade? They're all grades. All grades. I said, but how to do it the same way you did the other schools? I said, okay. So I get to the school. Maybe 400 or 500 students. Huge auditorium. And you know me, they told me to do like I did the other ones, so I did like I did the other ones, right? I went in, good morning! Good morning! If you believe that hope is the key, stand to your feet right now and say, hope is the key. So all of these blind students stood up because they could hear me. And the deaf students saw the blind students. They couldn't hear, but they could see. And then you had, they were in wheelchairs, and all of a sudden it just said, hope is the key. Hope is the key. Hope is, I mean, I couldn't stop them. I was like, hey, hope is the, I mean, they just kept going, right? And I'm sitting there like, I mean, tears running down my eyes, right? I'm like, man. I didn't read all these schools. They appreciated just that moment of just screaming, hope is the key. And so when I got done, I'm getting ready to leave, and the guy walked up to me, and I promise I'm ending right now. He said, I didn't want you to make me one of your hope dealers in Africa. I said, excuse me. I didn't want you to make me one of your hope dealers in Africa. I said, excuse me. He said, I want you to make me a hope dealer in Africa. I said, excuse me. He said, I want you to make me a hope dealer in Africa. You are a hope dealer. I said, hope dealer? You realize this sounds a lot like dope dealer? He said, you will be the number one hope dealer when you get back to the States. You bring us hope in South Africa. Make me a hope dealer now. Come, he make us hope dealers. So they stood in front of me, right? And I'm standing here like, okay, I'm done speaking. I'm headed to the airport. Like, this is the only thing between me and my 22-hour flight back to the States. I said, I make you a hope dealer now. I said, raise your right. Raise your right hand. And they raised their right hand. And since I left Africa, I end all of my presentations with making you a hope dealer. So everybody stand to your feet. You're about to become a Rotarian hope. I mean, not, you know, I know we have some judges, and, you know, I want you to go back here. We got some attorneys here, you know. Like, you know, he made us hope dealers. I don't know. All right, so you're going to raise your right hand and repeat after me, right? All right. Say, I am. An official. Mid-South. Patch. Hope. Dealer. I will live hope. I will give hope. I will help
other people excel. I will have only positive expectations. Say, I am an official Rotary Hope Dealer. My club, my district will deliver hope to the community, to the state, to this world. Say, we will create hope, give hope, live hope. All right, give me some volume on the music. Take it up a little bit. Can you turn it up just a little bit? Turn the music up just a little bit. Both hands up. So from this day forward, you don't have to say this, but I just, but I just need you to listen. From this day forward, I want you to think that when you see a problem, you see an opportunity to give hope. When you see despair, that's an opportunity to give hope. When you feel like it's not going to work, it's an opportunity to give hope. When I became president and I looked out and I said, man, we're in the middle of a pandemic. COVID. We had 200 exchange students on the University of North Alabama campus. So the money that we were spending for lunches, what did we do? We fed them. The first responders who were still helping people, we took that money and we fed them. We're not just making a difference, we are the difference. And it starts today. All right, hands up. Say, I'm a hope dealer. That's my time, man. You all have a great day.
Wow, I didn't go over.
Okay.
I did.
Yeah. Are you going to take him now?
Come on, I will.
Okay.
Can I? She said I had 10 minutes. I can just share. You, are you sure? Yeah. I just share. She said 10 minutes. I didn't want to leave anything on the table, but I will say this, that I share from this point of view. I remember coming home one night from church, and I'm driving my daughter's car. And my daughter had went off to college, and she didn't want to drive a car, so I took her. And I've been driving a car each night, and we're coming home from church, and my wife is in front of me, and my wife says, hey, your left headlight is out. I'm like, no, it's not. I'm still driving. She said, are you behind me? I said, I'm not sure, but she's like, you're behind me. The headlight is out. I'm like, it's not. She said, okay. We get home, she pulls in the driveway. When she pulls in the driveway, she gets out. And I get out. She said, get out the car, get out. I said, oh man, the headlight is, I must have just went out. And she said, I told you it was out. And I realized at that moment that the headlight might have been out. I couldn't see it because I was driving the car. And sometimes when we're driving the car, we can't see what's going on around us. So my perception of a Rotarian was different once I got on the inside and met Rotarians. But from the outside, it's like, man, these are just some old guys and old ladies who go and have lunch on Monday and talk about how great they are, you know? But then when I saw the things that were being done, I was like, wow. And that's why Chuck was instrumental, because I was like, why are we not telling our story? Why are we not telling the world all the things that we're doing? And and he said, that's why you're here. So when I say someone's destiny is tied to your assignment, it may just take you becoming a Rotarian for someone else to see and say, maybe I want to become a Rotarian as well, because they see the things that you're doing. But sometimes when we're inside of the, we can't see beyond that moment. We can't see the picture because we're in the frame. So sometimes just step outside of your club and look, and someone else may be able to show you something that's inside that you don't see. And that was hard, because when I became president, I had, whoo, you think this is energy. I was on Zoom. Okay, this is what we're going to do next, all right? All right, so and everybody was looking like, dude, you know, he realized that we're not meeting face to face. But I had my notes and I had stuff, you know, because I had gotten prepared for it. And right at the end, maybe the last month, we finally started meeting face to face. We start having these meetings, and I said, I want all the mayors. We got four mayors. I want them all here. We brought all four of the mayors, and I did a forum on race relations at the Rotary Club. It was pretty intense, you know what I mean? When we finished, everyone said, that was great. We should have been inviting the mayors and having all the... Sometimes those ideas that we think are crazy... Everyone say this with me. Same activities produce the same results. So in order to see something different, sometimes we have to do something different. Now, you know, in Rotary, you can't say we're going to do something different. I learned this from Tom Green, right? Tom says, don't tell them we're going to change. Just say that we're going to add something to what we're doing. So we can enhance it. I mean, he was giving me, because I would always run it by him and say, what do you think about it? That's a great idea. Now, in order to do that, you're going to need, you know, and you're doing too much. You got to delegate. And so as president, I'm telling you, and I would call him, and it's Dak DB, I don't. Okay, hey, Tim, be quiet. You might change your mind after this. No. But once I learned Dak DB and learned some of the things, there's always someone who's been where you're trying to go. But there's a reason why you were selected. There's a reason why you're about to be the president. There's a reason why you're in this room right now. There's a reason why I'm standing on this stage right now. I was this close to saying I'm not going to make it. My daughter got sick. She came home. Dad, my wife didn't make it. I said, yesterday my leg was hurting so bad. Found out I had 4 and 5 lower back is on the nerve. So before I got on the road yesterday, excited, Dad. So before I got on the road, they gave me a shot yesterday. And then they gave me some medicine. And I'm like, okay, if I could just make it to Chattanooga. Give me something to eat, take the med, go to sleep, wake up in the morning. I feel great right now. Listen. I mean, I feel like now in an hour, I may be, oh, Rotary, talking about. Everyone say ATM. See, I'm appreciating this moment. That I feel good. And that's what we have to do. And I want to leave you with that. And you come, I promise this time. Everyone say, appreciate the moment.
Appreciate the moment.
Yeah, that's good. All right, I'm going to leave like that. She tell me I got 5 minutes more, I'm going to keep going. All right, we go.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Wow, just wow. I don't know about you, but I love the passion that has been shown to us today, yesterday, day before, and it keeps getting better. And we will have some more of that good passion a little later today. And who knew we were going to have rotor size today? That was great.